Good mythical afternoon. This is Mr. Ayala with your next vlog. This is 4.2, 4.3, Colonial Governments and Culture. I do apologize for the audio and video quality on this video. I'm using a webcam that's a little bit different than what I usually do, but such is life. As always, please make sure you're writing your notes as you're going and that you are rewatching this as many times as you need to. Remember, some of the things will come out audio that I won't have on my PowerPoint, so please make sure you are paying attention. At the end of this, there will be a discussion board question. Make sure you complete that down in the doobly-doo or the discussion boards, wherever they may be this year, over here, over there, or over there, wherever it may be. So, to start off, it's principles of government, and we're going to start with the English principles of governments that began with the Magna Carta. It was signed in 1215 CE by King John, and what this does is limits the government's power. It more or less states that the government can only do certain things. Like how our Constitution states the government can only do certain things. It is a limited government. It cannot control everything. And then we get the English Bill of Rights of 1689, which gives all Englishmen certain protective rights, like the a trial by jury, to be able to face their accuser, basic freedoms of speech. And that all begins in 1689, and yet again will be put into our U.S. Constitution later. This also started, the Magna Carta also started the tradition of representative government, which when people elect representatives to make laws for them. And that's a Republican form of government, what we have here in the U.S. We, the voters, vote for people who represent our ideals, who go to Washington, D.C. or Tallahassee or any other major government, and vote based on what they ran on or who they represent. In England, this was through the House of Commons and the House of Lords. The government in the colonies are also based off the English system. Most had representative assemblies, like the House of Burgesses in Virginia, which is the very first representative assembly in the United States. And only men with land could vote. In particular, it was white men with land who could vote. Women could own land but could not vote. Interesting, have property rights, but not voting rights. And one of the big traditions in the U.S. is slowly but surely we add more people into voting. Starts with just white men with land, then all white men, and then all men with the passage of the 15th and 16th Amendment. Then later we add women and then 18-year-olds. Should be interesting to see if we extend that to a lower age group or what will occur. The economic theory was mercantilism, which was build wealth based on gold and silver and control the trade. So we want to have more exports than imports because you want to sell more stuff, send it out, than what you bring in, the imports. The colonies in particular were used for raw materials, lumber, sugar, tobacco, so on and so forth. And to control this trade, England passed what we call the Navigation Act, which forced all English colonists to only sell raw materials to England. No manufacturing was allowed, though they did trade rum, and no selling to others, which of course will increase smuggling. Brand new set of note for the idea of culture, 4.3. So life in the colonies, immigrants were important to the growth of the American colonies, and they adopted their new life and culture of America, or our concepts. And because of the idea of salutary neglect, which was one of your vocab words, we became extremely independent of our mother country. We actually did our own things. And though, because of all these people keep coming over, we do have large epidemics of smallpox, plague, and other diseases. Family in the colonies were, the men were the formal head of household, even though women do run the house. Women, so sons, back to the men, sons were usually apprentices or given out to craftspeople to actually continue to learn a skill, or they moved westward to get more land and more opportunity. Women ran the house. They could also run businesses and own property, but yet can't vote. Very interesting to me. American beliefs in general, education was valued by most colonists. And this actually starts with our background in Puritans, and schools were originally set up just for people could read and to read their Bible. And later, as the American colonies and the American government develops, there's going to be differences. I do apologize about that bell, and I'll be with you shortly. I do apologize about that jump cut right there. So this is American beliefs. As we were just talking about, education is valued by most colonists, and in particular, it comes from our background in Puritanism. The idea is that schools were set up and made so that everyone can actually read their Bible or their holy text. And from there, we actually end up evolving as we go throughout our society for that more and more people can join our education system, and it becomes more and more structured as we go on. From there, our next great American belief is the Great Awakening, which is the rebirth of Christian religion in the colonies, in particular Protestantism. And it emphasized the idea of greater religious freedom, the idea that it's okay to worship however you feel is fit. But if you do not have an ethic or moral background, that you will be going to hell. That's exactly what the whole idea of the Great Awakening is about. The best example are Jonathan Edwards and George Whitefield, which we will be looking at later. I do apologize if you are picking up any of my students in the background, because they have yet to figure out what be quiet means. So, from then, the Enlightenment. This was a movement in the mid-1700s that spread the idea of knowledge, reason, and science that could improve society. So this it promoted this is the idea that we are moving away from our religious texts and feelings on things, and more about observational scientific method ideas. The idea that, you know, we don't care what you feel about certain things. The idea is that we want the scientific proof that your opinion makes sense, that a natural phenomenon makes sense through scientific observations. And this promoted the idea of freedom of thought and expression, a belief in equality, and the idea of a popular government based off of these ideals. The most important example, of course, would be Mr. Benjamin Franklin. So one of the major ideas and problems was the idea of freedom of press. Because what happened is that the governors, who were royal governors at this time, wanted to censor more and more ideals. And so this censorship was the idea of banning materials that became unpopular or offensive ideas. And in the United States now, we actually are protected. Your freedom of speech is protected for everyone, even if you disagree with them. It's not about the people you agree with being protected, it's those who you disagree with. And so in 1733, we get to John Peter Zinger trial. He accused in his paper that the governor of New York was corrupt. And when this did happen, and he went to court, and he was found not guilty because he said, well, the governor is corrupt. I told you the truth. Why does it matter if I said it in my public newspaper? And the tradition of freedom of the press evolves from here. The idea that our press is the fourth pillar of our government. It starts with the three branches of government, and then the unknown fourth estate is our press. They are supposed to fact check our government and keep them honest. From there, we get the idea of civic virtue, or the ideas of freedom of spreading. This is based off of two major concepts from John Locke. John Locke believes since governments are made from men, they made that thus that only men can institute a government. And if a government refuses to protect your rights, you must overthrow that government. And this idea is known as the social contract, that there's a governmental contract between the government and those that it governs. And if the government refuses to protect the people, since there's a contract that goes both ways, we must rebel and overthrow that government or vote out people we disagree with. Because if we do know that all governments take more power, that is in their nature. And it's the nature of the people to stop that from occurring through the press, through voting, protesting, petition, so on and so forth. So, in the comments section for your vlog today, really, I need you to answer this. In what foundation of government, freedom of the press, representative republics, freedom of religion, limited government, or the social contract, do you believe is the most important in today's society? Make sure to explain yourself down in the doobly-doo, wherever it may be this year. I really don't know. And make sure that everything is spelled correctly. And as always, don't forget to be awesome.